Okay, so welcome to today's lecture. After Chris introduced you last week to the wonders of numerical computing with NumPy, today is actually time to get some pretty colorful figures with Matplotlib. So Matplotlib is the Python plotting package that more or less everyone is using because it's so flexible that you could really create any kind of figure that you can imagine with it, but it's also straightforward to make quick plots if you have to. So just for a general introduction, there's online documentation for Matplotlib, which is one of its great strengths. So there's a gallery that's very nice, so we can take a look at it here. And the cool thing about the gallery is that there are a lot of example plots, and often you just think, okay, I want to make this plot, I just need to figure out how. And then you don't want to read through pages of API documentation, you just want to get to the code that produces a plot. So here in the gallery you can find all kinds of plots, and then you can just, for example, this pretty heart shape, you can go here and like find the code that generates this plot, and you can just copy it and adapt it for your own needs. Also, Matplotlib has a very vivid community, so if you need help, you can always ask on Stack Overflow. And so it's also good practice, just to say this right now, if you have a question on Stack Overflow or find an answer that helps you on Stack Overflow, that you actually upvote this question. So I see a lot of people going around without ever being logged in on Stack Overflow and then just consuming answers, but it doesn't really hurt anyone to give a little bit back if other people help you. So I would encourage you here to be part of the community and actively participate here. And yeah, there's also a GitHub repository, so if you find bugs, you can make an issue there. So before we actually get started, we need to have a little bit background on something called backends in Matplotlib. So the way Matplotlib is very flexible, you can create a lot of different figure formats like PNGs, SVG, SVG, and PDF, and whatever, and have a lot of interactive backends also. And the way this works is that you like, yeah, you can target different backends, but still use the same code, so to say. However, this is usually done automatically. So for us, what just matters is that, so when we import Matplotlib, we could ask for the backend, and we would see, okay, here it's the IPy kernel backend inline. So that is good, because now we automatically get our plots shown in the notebook. And we could also make this explicit by calling so to say, a magic command here with this starting with a percent sign calling, saying matplotlib inline. And as we will see later, it's also possible to do matplotlib widget when you want to have interactive plots in the notebook. However, we will see this later. Okay, so let's actually get started with the plots. So before we actually make the plots, I want to give a little bit background on how we talk about the plots that matplotlib produces, as this greatly helps you to actually create the figures that you want in the end. So looking at this figure, which is now a bit too big actually, so if you see this whole window, so this is what we would call a figure. So everything that we create with a plot, that's the figure. So and on this figure we will have different subplots, often just one subplot, and this subplot is for some reason also called an axis. So it's probably called axis because it also contains of usually two different axes, or axes, an x-axis and a y-axis. So this is why this whole thing that contains all the data and all the color is called an axis. So it gets sometimes get used to this word, but actually it's not very difficult. So this is just the main thing. So here we have two axes on this whole axis, and then we have different axes inside a figure. So now let's actually start to make some figures. So what we do here, we import some stuff, and then we can, so the way you import matplotlib is you import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. So last week you saw that you usually import NumPy as NP, so for these packages that you use a lot, it's very common to introduce some kind of shorthand so you don't always have to write the full name. So here it's PLT, and then we can go and start plt.figure and create a new figure. And we see, well, that nothing really happens except that some string representation is showing up. So this is because when you want to show a matplotlib figure, you first have to show it usually. So usually build up your figure, and then in the end, when you are done with setting up everything, you call show. However, in the notebook, this also doesn't work because our figure is empty right now. So what we would need to actually see some kind of figure, we need to add some axes to our figure. So the way this works is after creating the figure object, you call add subplot on this figure, and then we see that we already get returned an axes object. So this is the subplot thing. And then we can show, call show, and we actually see some empty plot. Wow, okay. So also this syntax, we'll see later why we have to do this. Let's just proceed for now, but see that we can also customize the call to figure, so we can pass a different fix size. So for example, what you can do is you can call fig aspect and say, okay, I want to have a figure that's 2 times height as wide. So by setting fig aspect to 2, you could also set it to 0.5, I guess, and it would be the other way around, 2 times wide as high. And usually what you often do is also you just pass a direct tuple of inches to it. So you say, okay, I want my figure to be 5 inches wide and 6 inches, well, let's say 10 inches high. And then my prototype will also create the figure the size you specified before. So now we just have an empty plot. And very importantly, before we start to put actually some data on it, we want to annotate it properly, because nothing is worse than a plot that doesn't have axis labels and annotation, where you just have colorful spots, but it doesn't mean anything. So for a scientific figure, you always should have some labels. So let's see how you can achieve this. So again, we make our figure, we add a subplot here, and then we can call in our axes object, we can call things like setting the x limits, setting the y limits, and also setting title and labels. So let's just see the result of that. So by calling x limit, for example, 0.5 to 4.5, we see that now the x axis is in exactly that range. And because we set a title here at the top of the plot, we now have a title. And also we have x axis, we have axis labels. So to have like a shorthand for this kind of thing, because you often need to do this and then you don't always want to write set this, set this, and so there's a shorthand for this. You can just call set and then you pass a bunch of keyword arguments, and matplotlib will automatically determine what kind of settings should be done. So you can just pass all the things that we had here as keyword arguments and it will achieve the exact same result. So after all that kind of fuss, we're actually ready to plot some data on our figures. So the way this works is pretty straightforward. You just call on the axis that you created plot. And you pass usually two, for simple plots, just 2 arrays or 2 lists or 2 kind of collections. And the first collection is for the x-axis, for the x values, and the second is for the y values. So if you do this, we actually get a line on our plot here, and we see that the line actually has points there where we specified it. So we have the first point at 110, then we have the second point at 220, and then 325 and 435. And we see that the points are connected by a straight line. So this is the default that Matplotlib will just interpolate between these points by connecting things with a straight line. So what you will often see when you look at like older Matplotlib code on the internet is that people use a pyplot interface, or so to say the state machine interface. So what we will use here in this lecture is the object-oriented interface, because we want to do proper programming and because it's also a lot better to keep control over your figures. But what you can also do, and what Matplotlib provides, because it was originally created by as a substitute for MATLAB, which has or had this, or still has probably this kind of syntax, so that you just call a function called plt.figure, then you call plt.plot, and then you call show. And just by some hidden magic in the background, Matplotlib would know that when you call plot here, that you would actually want to plot on the figure that you created before. However, you don't explicitly connect your objects as we do it here, when we retrieve first the figure, then we retrieve an axis, and then we call the plot method on this axis, on this axis. So this is also possible to do for really quick and dirty code, but usually I would not recommend it, and for any kind of complex figures, this gets quickly out of hand. And to convince you of this, you can also look at the Zen of Python, which you can get by importing this. And then you will get some verses that you can meditate over at home. And just for looking at the very first things, that, okay, beautiful is better than ugly, that we can all agree on. However, then we say explicit is better than implicit, and this is also why we use the object-oriented interface and don't use an interface where we just get objects created in the background and then called in the background. So with this, we can go on to creating multiple axes or multiple subplots on the same figure. And the way we do this is also pretty simple. We use a function called plt.subplots. So be aware that there's also a function called plt.subplot, which does something different, which is more part of this state machine interface, which we don't want to use. So make sure that you put an S here. And then you can simply put arguments like number of rows, number of columns. Here we have 2 and 2. And then we get, in the end, 4 axes on our figure. Because we said, OK, we want to have 2 rows and we want to have 2 columns. And this gives us 4 in the end. And then we get 4 different axes. And the nice thing about using plt.subplots is also that we get both a reference to the figure and to the axes that we created. So it's very like convenient also for single plots. I use like this function all the time. As we will see right away, you can also call this without arguments, and then you just get a single figure and a single axis, and then you can just plot on it as before. So the way that this axis object here is returned here is actually as an array. So since we now have 4 different axes here, we get an array of 2 times 2 axes, and we can, this is actually a NumPy array, so you can, we can use this indexing that we got to know last week. So we can index the upper left, axis here by putting 0, 0, and so on. And by doing this, we can see how we can reference all these axes that we get returned here. So we can see, okay, this is the upper left, and 1, 1 would be the lower right, and so on. Yeah. Oh, this, okay, so this is really just tuple unpacking. So this is nothing special about matplotlib, but just about Python. So when you have, let's say, when you have a tuple of 2 elements, so you have 1 and 2, and now you want to unpack these elements of the tuple onto some variables, you can just do this. And then subsequently, the first element will be bound to A, and the second element will be bound to B. So yeah, subplots is just returning a tuple of figure and an axis collection or array. And then we just usually bind this to some variable so we can directly work with it. So yeah, so as I just said, you don't need to use this code usually, where you first create the figure and then add a subplot, but you can directly create the figures and the subplots in a single command using plt.subplot. So I would always prefer this syntax because it's shorter and also much nicer. And then finally, we'll see that we can also add super titles to our figure. So we saw that we can set a title on each axis, but we can also set a title for the whole figure by calling fig.subtitle. So for super title, when we do this, we see that we now have a separate title that sits over the whole figure. Okay, so with this, enough talking. I would say let's get to the first exercise. I hope you all opened up your binder thing. If not, just here's the just again, so here's when you go to our repository, click Launch Binder and navigate to the lecture, week 5, and there you should find an environment that's set up for doing the exercises right away. So the first exercise would be to reproduce this figure somehow with what I just showed you. So here we have like 3 different sine waves, and you can use the code below to get started. So here we already have the titles and the different arrays, which are just shifted cosines, so you can try to plot them. And let's give it 5 minutes for this, and I will start the counter. while you can already start. Okay. So, who managed to create or recreate the figure already? Okay, not so many people. What were the problems that you had? Anyone wants to say something? Yeah.
The individual values for the different blocks, for the different axes. So
Yeah, okay. Okay, so then let's look at the solution, how you would do this. So the idea here is that first you again use the subplots function to create three different subplots. Maybe we can do this line by line. So right, if you say just n rows equals 3, you would already have this basic setup. And then what you want to do is you get a bunch of axes and you have a bunch of values that you want to plot on these axes. So most conveniently, you just zip them together, right? You have three axes and you can make a list of the three different arrays that you want to plot and also the names that you would use for the titles. And then you can just on each different axes, you can call the plot function and just plot the right values on it. So this looks like this because I didn't execute the cell. So this already looks like this. And then to make it a bit nicer, we call this function that we will discuss in a bit more detail later, which is called plt.titleLayout, which just takes care of making your plot look a bit nicer so that you don't have these overlapping labels. But if you find this a bit hard to wrap your head around, so this would be just equivalent to doing something like accessing each axis individually. So you get an, let's just look at the axis array maybe. So what we get back here is an array, a not really a NumPy array of type object where you have these three different axes inside. And then you can just index them individually and say, okay, on the first axis, I want to plot. Yeah, x against y1 and make it black and then use the name. What did we have here? Let's say like names also at 0 and then call x1 y1 and this would for example just plot on the first axis because we only call plot on the first axis object and the code for the rest would be just equivalent here, but you can makes this a bit nicer if you loop just over the different axes and things. Okay, does this make sense? Kind of cool. So with that, you are equipped with the basic tools to create and annotate matplotlib figures. However, right now we can just plot lines, which is a bit limited. However, matplotlib provides a great variety of differing plotting functions that you can utilize and customize any way you like. So, and this section should give you a basic overview over these different functions. So, just very broadly, we'll have some images here. So, as we already saw, axis.plot is just for creating lines or points when you have x and y values. So, you can make straight lines, you can make them dotted or whatever, or you can also just plot points or lines in combinations. Then there's scatter for combining higher dimensional data. So if you do not just have x, y values, but also other values, then you could also influence the size or the color of points. Then you could use the bar plot, axis.bar to make different kind of bar plots. You can also make different kind of fillings between different kind of values. You can show images. And you can make these color meshes, which is like more a specialized thing. And if you are very fancy, you can also do vector fields. So this might actually be useful if you are into dynamical systems like neuroinformatics and stuff. And probably most important for everyone, you can plot different statistical distributions with common plots. And we will look at all of those in detail right now. So we start with the bar plot. So the idea is here that we make five values here and then we make a bunch of random values, also the number of five, and then we can just call, again we make some axis in the figure and then we call axis.bar on the x and y values and we get something like this. So just to make this more explicit again, so x is really just an array that counts from 0 to 4 and y in this case would be the height of the different bars, so we see that, okay, this value is very low, and this is also reflected in the height of the bar here. What you often want to do, you want to quantify your errors, so you need to add some error bars, and this is also very easily done by just passing a separate or third argument to the bar function, which is called y error for y error, and you just plot an you just pass an array of the same size, and then you get this kind of error bars on top of your bars. Yeah.
Yeah.
So seed is for when you, so what we do here, we use the NumPy random module. And when we generate random numbers, we want to get usually random numbers, but for reproducibility reasons, we like to get the same random numbers at times so that you, all of you who execute this notebook see the same plot here. So we see this when we execute this several times, we always get the same plot because we always get the same random numbers. And this is like when you seed your random number generators, you will always get you the same random numbers. If we exclude this line, we will always get different kinds of plots. The 2 doesn't do anything special, so seed is really just you have like this whole range of random numbers and you want to say a random number generator at some point start here. And this will mean that it will always start at the same point and always from there produce the same random numbers. But you can use any number that you like, you should just stick with one so that you get reproducible results. Okay. So these were the error bars, and then you can also just introduce a utility function called axisHline, so axHline, which is a bit redundant if you call this on the axis, because then we have code like axis.axis, but however, this is because it's the same as like in the plt.xline. And what this does, just to keep it short, is it draws a horizontal line. That's why it's called h-line. So you just have to pass a y-value, and then you can pass some customization options. So in this case, we want to make it black and make it a bit wider. And then we get a bit, when we get a horizontal line in between here. And now to have a bit, to use this to have a bit deeper look at the inner workings of matplotlib is, we will see that actually every plotting function, so whether it's x.plot or x.bar, turns, also has a return value, and this return value is usually in matplotlib artist. So artist is a class, or like an important class for the matplotlib, in the matplotlib world, and the thing about an artist is it's just something that draws itself on the plot. So in this case, we can take the return value of ax.bar, and then we can set again values on this different artist. So right now all the artists for the different bars here are blue, but we can say something like, okay, iterate over all the artists and the y values that belong to them, and then say, okay, if the y value is below 0, then make the artist red, or make the color of the artist red. And this is all that is needed to do to make all the bars that are below 0 different colors. So this is sometimes useful for customizations, that you can get a hold of the artists that make up your plot and that you can really customize them in any way you want. But usually the defaults are also fine, and then you can just call the plotting functions without explicitly saving the return values. So yeah, again, we can just look at the artist values that are returned from the x.plot function, and we see when we print them that all of those are just rectangles. So we see that at a very low level, matplotlib has also these primitives for creating geometrical shapes. So if you really want to, you can also use matplotlib as a drawing tool, but it's probably not the most convenient way. But if you really have to make a very special figure for some occasion, then matplotlib is still powerful enough to do that. So next up is these fill plots. So what you can do, if you have x and y values, you can call fill between, and this will, at the very basic configuration, just instead of just drawing a line, will fill the space between the y value and 0. So this is usually not so very useful. However, it can be sometimes useful to like illustrating envelopes of data. So if you have an error band or something that you want to have around a line, you can use this to color the area that is between two values. And this is also a good occasion to introduce a different way to pass data to your plotting functions. So right now we explicitly pass separate arrays of data. However, what you can also do is you can pass dictionary-like objects. So let's say you have a dictionary here, and this dictionary has different keys, and the keys map to different arrays. And then you can call the plotting function by just referring to the keys with the strings in the dictionary and not by directly referring to the arrays. And in the end, you just pass data as a keyword, like pass a data object that you have there. And this is not so useful for NumPy arrays, but this will be useful later when we talk about data frames, because data frames can be accessed in this exact way. So, and this is in a very explicit way also to refer to your different data that you have here. So this reads a bit better than if you have just an array and then you say data object at 0 and 1 or so. So now we can see what we plot here, and this just gives the exact same plot that we had before. So then what's also nice is when we have 2D data. So right now we're just at 1D data, right, where you have like some X and some Y values, but often you have grids of data, like images most of the time. And Matplotlib can also handle those. So let's start by just creating some 2D data. We just make an array, and then we shape it to 3x3, so we have a two-dimensional array. And then to display this array, we can use the function imShow, which means like image show, show an image, yeah. And this is called the same way as before. You would call it on the axes that you created before, and then you pass the 2D array to it. And we will see that for each value that we have here in our 2D array, we get a nicely colored patch now in our shown image. This also works with real images. So there's also a function called imRead, which reads an image from the file system. So here we just pass path to an image here, and then we call imShow on whatever this returned here. And we see that we get a nice picture of, I think it's like some SpaceX rocket here. So, and what is also usually nice when you want to show images is that you turn the axis off, which means that you don't have these tick marks here at the bottom, because it's, when you have a real image, it's not so really meaningful. So by default you would get this, and you would get a measurement of the pixels that you have on the image, but if you don't want to see this, then just turn it off and you will see the image just as it is. If, however, you have some kind of matrices that you want to visualize because you want to see what's going on there, then there's also a function called matShow, which has a bit nicer defaults for displaying that. So instead of putting the labels here and putting them continuously, they are put in the middle and they are counted from zero here. So this is nice if you do some linear algebra and you want to visualize what's going on. So however, one problem with this kind of mapping an image to, or mapping a 2D array to some color values, is that until now we don't have any idea what the colors actually mean. So in which relation does yellow stand here to the blue in the left corner? So, and for that we can use color bars. So the way you do this is you call color bar on the figure, or first you retrieve the artist or the return value of axis.imShow. And then you call color bar on the figure using this return value again. And then you get a color bar by the side of the image that basically shows you how the different color values in your plot map to the range of your original data. So we saw that in our original array, we had values from 0 to 8. And we now also see this reflected in our color bar here. And now from this, we can actually read that this value here must be something between 4 and 5 or so. Actually just 4 exactly. So if you use some color mapping and don't have a color bar, it's the same as making a normal plot and don't put any axis labels on there. So make sure to put a color bar so people can understand the range of your values. Okay, so these color bars are by default. What they do is they shrink the original image a bit and just put the color bar next to it. This is also why a color bar is called on the figure instead of the axes, because the color bar is not plotted on the axes, but it's a new axis that is created for it. So this is, so to say, also a subplot. This is just looks very different from this subplot, but it's also on the same figure and just put besides the other subplot. And if you want to, or if you are not satisfied with the location that your color bar is put to, you can also customize this. There's anything in Matplotlib. So you could explicitly add an axis to the figure and passing as four values here the exact location of the axis that you want to have. And then when you call color bar, you can pass this as a CX argument, so the axis for the color bar. And when you do this, you can put the color bar anywhere you want on your image, also on top of the other axes, if this for some reason seems useful. So in general, when you work with mappings from some range of data to some other, yeah, like some color range, there are a bunch of arguments that you will see over and over again. So we will show you how to use them, or I will show you. So what we do here is we load some data, and then we just show them again, and we use a different color map here. So by using the cmap argument of the imshow function, we can map our data to some different range or to some different color map, actually. So this is called seismic, this color map here. And we see that it's like, it doesn't go like here from blue to yellow, but it goes from blue to red and has white in the middle. So this is something called a diverging color map if you want to emphasize that data can go in both directions. However, the problem here is that white, which would naturally represent zero or the middle of your data range, is now not in the middle. Because by default, what Matplotlib does is when you pass this image here to color bar, looks at the range of data and then, okay, looks at the color map and sees, okay, this is, it goes from this value to this value, and now let's put the minimum and maximum of my data on this value range, on this color range. So what you need to do when you want to avoid this and want to have your color ranges be a bit more meaningful depending on how you use them, you can put a vmin and a vmax argument to imshow, and this will tell Matplotlib, do not take the minimum and the maximum of my data, but instead use these values as minimums and maximum values for my data. And when we do this, we see that now zero is actually in the middle, and which makes this plot look a lot more meaningful, because we now see that most of it is actually nothing, and we just have some values going here in different directions, but we didn't really have any values different from zero here, which was really hard to see when you don't have zero in the middle. So with that, we get to the next exercise, which is again, so I guess more or less all of these exercises are reproducing some figures which were with the commands that you learned before. So again here, we have like three different two-dimensional data sets, so to say, that we create here. So we have data 1, data 2, and data 3. And the way we produce them here is we generate random numbers again, and we scale for data 2, we scale them by 2, and for data 3, we scale them by 3. But now we still want to have all of them on the same color range, so to say, so that we actually see these differences. And therefore, you should find a way to display a color bar, because you don't really need to put so much effort in this, because like the axis for the new color bar is actually created. Now you just need to plot the images on the data and make sure that the data range stays in the range that it's supposed to be in. Okay, so let's again try this for 5 minutes and say something if you need any help or have questions. Okay, so I see people mostly looking at their laptop still, but like who managed to do the exercise? Matplotlib seems to be harder than I expected. So anyway, so the solution is actually not that hard once you get the idea. So again, we use a trick that we did in the first exercise, that we have a bunch of values and we just want to zip them all together. So we use our axes here, our data. So we just say, okay, for each axis, we want to plot different data. And to be able to iterate over our axes, we call dot flat here, but actually not sure if this is needed. No, actually not. So let's just do it this way, because axis is just a single dimensional array in this case. And we call on each axis object, we call I'm show with the data, and we set vmin to 0 and vmax to 3, because the maximum value of all of these three arrays is 3, because yeah, random.random just generates numbers between 0 and 1, so if you multiply this by 3, you get at most 3, and then in the end, you just have to add the color bar again and pass the cx that we created before here, and say you want to have it horizontally, and then this is the way it looks. Okay, so is this understandable from what we did here? Okay, then let's proceed a bit just very shortly to scatter plots. So scatter plots is just like a term for when you have different dimensions on data and you want to put them all on a single figure, and you want to just look at the data for first glance, and what scatter, so the function axis.scatter provides here that you can pass more than one array and map them in some meaningful way to different geometrical attributes or graphical attributes of your plot. So we see, okay, we have here three different data, three different arrays, and then also a y value that's a combination of all of them. So, and then we can say something, okay, map the first one to x, map the second one to y, or map y to y, and then map x2 to the size of our points, and map x3 to the color of our points. And so we have like all these different arrays represented in a single plot, but we will come back to this mapping of different data to different aesthetics or different geographical attributes later in the lecture on statistical visualization. For now, just it's for you to get to know the scatter function. So then let's talk a bit about visualizing statistical distributions. So often when you want to do any kind of data analysis or science, you have you sample some data and then you get a distribution, and then you want to somehow investigate this distribution. So, and there are a lot of like default tools for doing that, and Matplotlib offers them all, and we will see how we can do that. And for now, let's just create a distribution, just a normal distribution, and this is also a good time to introduce or to have a small side note on Unicode variables as or Unicode characters as variables. So in the old times of programming, you couldn't use anything except ASCII characters. So if you want to represent a mu, a Greek letter, you would write it out something like this. In the modern times of Unicode, you can use any kind of Unicode character as an identifier. So you can also do stuff like this to have, and what IPython provides here, if you type like LaTeX notation and type backslash mu and put press tab, you get the Greek letter directly here in your console. And this is just like really a totally valid character like anyone else. So if you have, if you're dealing with a domain where you have strong conventions on using some Greek letters or also other symbols for identifying some kind of concepts, for example, in statistics where you use mu and sigma for representing mean and standard deviations of distribution, it can actually make your code more readable. If you use Greek letters, it actually makes it more readable than typing mu. However, often it's like you shouldn't overuse this, because in the end your code will just be full of Greek letters, and the idea is rather to have people understand your code. So instead of writing mu, you could also just write mean, for example, and then no one has to know the convention, but can just figure out what it's supposed to be just by the name of the variable. So that's just a feature to know about. So what we do here, we generate numbers from a random normal distribution. So, and we get back a, let's see here, just a single dimensional array of a lot of values that are generated from this normal distribution. And we can plot this, for example, by using a histogram. So this is done by calling ax.hist, and we pass the distribution, and then we just get a nice looking histogram. And from what we know about normal distributions, we can see that this looks kind of normal because we have most of the mass in the middle and the other mass distributed evenly around the mean at zero. And just to recap these techniques again, what a histogram does is like it puts your data into bins. So each bar that you see here is like a bin in your data. So we would see, okay, we look at all the data points from here to here, and then we count the number of data points that fall into this bin. And the count of this data points makes up the height of the bars. So we can see that in this bar here, or in this bin, we had like 200, like maybe 230 values, and in this bin from here to here, we only had like 100 values. So this is what a histogram does. If the number of bins is not looking promising, you can also control them manually by setting the number of bins to some value. So here we divide up our data in 50 evenly spaced bins. This way the data distribution might come out a bit better, but might also be a little bit too strong. So if you make this too fine-grained, in the end you will just have one or like maybe just a few in each bin. So and then this will not really represent what you are looking at. So if you don't want to think about this too much, you can also pass bins equals auto, which is so the string auto, and this will automatically determine the right number of bins by using some measurements of how like to maximize the difference between the different bins, so to say. And this is usually a good start if you haven't looked at the distribution before. And finally, if you want to don't have the count of the data, but have more something that could represent the actual probability density, you can pass the keyword density equals true, and then all your data will be scaled so that the sum over all of those bins will sum up to one. So you could interpret now the values as kind of probabilities for values falling into that bin. Or probability densities more, not really probabilities. So then another very popular way to investigate univariate random distributions is the box plot. So just as simple as that, we just call box plot on the axis and we get a box plot. So now, who knows what a box plot actually represents? Okay, some people. Good, so I also had to look it up, admittedly. So what a box plot represents is like you have this thing in the middle, which is the median of the data. So the idea is just that you calculate some summary statistics on your data that represent your data distribution in a single value, and then you plot them somehow and combine them in this box here. So this is the median in the middle. And then you have here, you have the 25 and 75 percentiles of your data. So you can think of like the whole distribution up until here is like 25%, and up until here you will have 75% already of your data points covered in this area. And then you look at the space between those two quartiles here, so this is going to call it the interquartile range, and then you look at 1.5 times this from here, and you draw like this so-called whisker here and up until here, and the same way into this direction. And you say, okay, this is like really the proper range of my data, and everything that is beyond that you call an outlier or a flyer, and this is plotted individually. So every point that you see here is actually a real data point from our data set that we put in there, and those should show like how many outliers are there. So this is like when we have a normal distribution, we see, okay, we have the median at zero, we have most of the mass near the median, and then we have like things like going out up until three or so. So yeah, you can customize box plots in a lot of ways. So you can make them blue or make some little indents here that then again represent the confidence in the position of the median. But just knowing that you can also change the way your box plots look. However, what you can also do with the boxplot function, which is nice if you do not just have a single distribution, but a bunch of distributions. So here we generate a lot of normal distributions from with different means and different standard deviations here. So actually just 5 of them. So the first one would be have a mean at 0, the second one at -1, and so on. And when you have an array of those arrays, you can also pass them all to boxplot, and then it will draw a boxplot for each individual data distribution. So we see here our first one was with mean 0 and then a small standard deviation. And then this here is mean the mean of -1 but has a huge standard deviation of 5, so the box plot is a lot larger. And then a third alternative to box plot are so-called violin plots. So violin plots have a similar intention as box plots. Okay, let's look at them. So we call them using violin plot, and it's called violin plot because it kind of looks like a violin sometimes. Sometimes also it looks more like a kebab thing. Okay. However, so the idea is that instead of having this like summary statistics that you compute here and then you draw boxes, you try to estimate the probability density that underlies your distribution. So you use some kernel density estimators, which we won't go into detail here, and then you try to fit them to your distribution, and then you say, okay, with all the data points that I got to see, this might be the actual probability density that generated these values. And so this gives you like a more smooth way to look at the data. However, you need like, you should have at least a few data points, but you should always have a few data points if you want to investigate distributions, right? If you just have 5 data points, probably doesn't make too much sense. So yeah, you can, well, depends on the situation or whatever you like better. So on violin plots also behave like box plots in being able to plot a bunch of distributions beside each other. So yeah, and for me, if we compare this here, so I mean, here what I find more intuitive about violin plots is that you can see that the data is skewed more intuitively. So you see here that you have like a skew in the data here. However, when you look at the box plot here, you would have to read this from, okay, the median is closer to this quarter than to this quarter, and this gives you in the end the same information, but this is like, for me at least, more interpretable, but it also depends on what you are used to. So, and finally, and probably not so very useful, there are pie charts. You can make pie charts if you have different, yeah, if you have a distribution that is chunked up into different categories or so. But there's probably more use in, like, I don't know, popular literature than science. Okay, however, let's just end this section with a final exercise. So just make these 3 plots that I now introduced to you and combine them in a single figure using the dist value. So really just this thing that we computed before. And yeah, if you need a hint on how to make this histogram look this way, you can look at the hint. So yes, exactly. So just the dist variable that we used before. So, and for this, let's schedule in 3 minutes. Okay. So anyone already managed to do the plot? Okay. Some people, it's cool. So let's just look at the solution, which is really just you would create a figure and an axis array using subplots, and you would say, okay, I want to have three columns because they are all side by side. And we make the fig aspect a bit different so the plot looks a bit nicer. And then we call on all of those axes subsequently, first the histogram, then the box plot, and then the violin plot function. And for the histogram, we pass the keyword orientation equals horizontal. So in this way, the histogram gets turned horizontally. And now we can also a bit easier compare what these plots represent about our distribution. So this is like the non-parametric view where you would bin, then you would see, okay, this is looking at summary statistics, and this is drawing like a smooth curve over this histogram here. Okay, so next up, look at annotating plots. So when you want to make a scientific figure and you want to emphasize that it supports your finding, you often need to manually annotate it and say, okay, this is really the data that supports my hypothesis. This is like, for example, when you have an MRI scan or whatever, this is the region where we found the activity or so, and this cannot easily be done or derived from the data, but you manually need to say, okay, here I want to have an annotation. And the way you do this is using annotate. So on the axis here, there's an annotate function, and you can specify a string here, and then some x and y values as a tuple, and then a string will be put into your plot at this exact x and y position. So for example, here we want to emphasize that this, in fact, is a local maximum, and so we put the string local maximum here on our cosine plot. So this is not so really nice because the text is now directly to the point that we want to emphasize and actually covers it. So what you want to do instead is probably move the text a bit away from the position. So you can pass a second argument called xyText to annotate and say, okay, why I want to emphasize a point here. Actually, I want my text to be here. And when you do this, you will see that your text is now moved at this position. So we see, okay, it's 3.5 and 1.5. Somehow it's here, okay. So now the problem is that there's no connection between your point and your text anymore. And the way you solve this is simply by using an arrow. So to achieve this, you just need to pass a fourth argument to annotate, which is called arrow props. And arrow props is the dictionary of properties of the arrow that should connect the text and the point that you want to emphasize. And just putting any arrow props here will already create an arrow. So in this case, we just say, okay, we want to shrink the arrow a bit by 10%. And this means that at both sides, it will be a little bit smaller, so that it does not directly overlap with the data. If we just pass an empty dictionary, it will still create an arrow, but now the arrow will be directly starting at the data point that we have here. So shrink is usually useful, I guess. However, there are a million different properties that you can pass to this arrow props dictionary. So for example, what we do here, we say, okay, we want to have a different styled arrow. Styled is wedge, and we want to have a different connection style. And by doing this, we will get now a curved arrow that has is made up from different splines and will actually be look like this. Yeah, and just to practice this, a small exercise again. So now instead of highlighting this point, you should highlight a local minimum and use a fancy arrow for that. So you can maybe try to look at the documentation of annotate, how to make a fancy arrow, or you can just try out any different arrow style. And yeah, for this, let's just do this for 2 minutes. Yeah, okay. So the solution for this would be just analogous to the plot above here. Just pick any local minimum. In this case, we look at 2.5 and minus 1, so that would be about here. And then we put our y-text a little bit to the side and say, okay, let's use the arrow style fancy to actually get a fancy arrow. And yeah, this looks like this. So this way you can put arrows inside your plot and highlight different parts of it. There are also a lot of other ways to annotate things by using patches or rectangles or ellipses or so, but for this, if you need to, you can look at the documentation about annotations here. Okay, so until now we covered a lot of different plotting functions that you can use out of the box. However, you still have the problem that you cannot really customize the plots that you make. And for this reason, the next section is called how to speak MPL or how to speak Matplotlib, because there's really a vocabulary that underlies Matplotlib and that you can use at many different positions and times, and that is doesn't really change over the different functions that you can use. So there's always a similar way to refer to colors and shapes and different styles, and we will cover this in this section. So yeah, the first thing is about colors. So to get started, we just make a basic plot here. We call plot with different, so this is just we make some values here called t, and then we call like t, we plot t against t to the power of 2 and t to the power of 3. And we put some different line width here already to make the lines a bit more visible. But you see that by default, Matplotlib will choose different colors for each different line that you plot here without you explicitly specifying that you wanted a different color. This usually makes sense because different lines probably represent different data, so you also want them to look differently. However, now you want to customize the colors of these different lines. And there are a bunch of color names by which you can refer to different colors. So these are the standard ones. You can just have a single letter and have a full name for different colors. And this is also a very common thing in Matplotlib, that you have either full names for different attributes or you also have abbreviations. So if you just want to quickly make a plot, you can use abbreviations if you know them, but if you do not know them or do not remember them, you can still go back to the full names and have this a bit more readable. So the way you would do this is you pass the color argument and then you pass some string here. So this will make the first line blue. I'll just look at this. So make the first line blue, then make the second line green, just as a letter here, and then make the third line red. And there's a full list here of 147 different color names that you could use in this position. However, there are a lot more colors than just these 147, so you can also refer to colors by hexadecimal values. So if you go online and look for some color picker or so, you can often find the colors in a hexadecimal representation, and like probably very few people can read or understand what color this actually would be, but you can usually just copy the value and put it here and this will work as well. So in this case, you would just have the hexadecimal string and have a hash before that. Then you can also make refer to different gray colors here. And the way you would do this is still you would use a string, but you would inside the string have a floating point value that is between 1 and 0. So what we do here, right, we have, I can make this a bit bigger also again. So F1.8, which would be then this light gray, and then have 0.2, which would be already almost black. So you can say if we make this so, it will be totally black, and if we make this 1, it will be, should be, I guess, totally white. Yeah, so we don't see it anymore. So this is how you divide up the range between white and black in all numbers between them, and you can have different gray values if for some reason you don't like colors that much. You can also do RGBA tuples. So RGBA, just red, green, blue, are a typical way to reference colors, and it's also a bit more human readable than hex values, for example. So, and the way you do this, you pass a tuple here, and you pass values between, now this time not strings, but really floating point numbers between 0 and 1. So 1 would be that you have like the full color, and 0 would be that you don't have any of this, have the absence of the color. So as this is red, green, blue, so this would represent blue. This would represent a mixture between green and blue, and this would be again just blue, but then as a fourth element of the tuple, you can specify the transparency or the alpha channel, and so you would only have 30% of this blue here. So this is how it would look, right? This is totally blue, this is a mixture between green and blue, and this is the same color as above here, but it's a bit more transparent. So then, a different way to, again, specify colors is using so-called cycle references. So as we saw above here, if we don't specify any colors, we still get different colors. So this is because internally Matplotlib uses a cycle, and it cycles through a bunch of different values and colors by default for each plot that you call. So you could also reference each element of the cycle by using string C and then 1, 2, 3. So this is, if you don't like the way it's cycled, you can, so to say, use the second cycle color as the first color and so on. And yeah, if we just compare this maybe for not having any colors. We would see that basically all colors got shifted one up, and we now have here the third color as the first, and then so on. Actually, probably the cycle starts at 0. Yeah, so this is why we have the red here as well, because C3 is not in our original value range here. Okay, so in addition to using different colors, which is a powerful aesthetic element to represent data, there are also different kinds of markers. So if you have different kinds of data, you might want to plot different kinds of points to represent them. And just to get an overview here, so this is all the different markers that Matplotlib offers. So you can have cycles, and you can have squares or diamonds or crosses or whatever you can imagine here. And the way you pass those is that you have a marker argument to the plot function, and you can pass a string that represents this marker here. So usually, like, these strings are chosen as to kind of resemble the marker that they will in the end create. So by doing this, we see, okay, here now we have a fourth line that goes a bit in the minus direction. We will see that V is actually a triangle that points down. We will have pluses here. We have small dots here for the first thing, and we have bigger dots represented by an O here. So there are a lot of different things that you can play with and try out. And then now the next thing that you can customize is so-called line styles. So if you do not just want to plot markers, but to actually plot a line, so I have Matplotlib interpolate between the values, by default you just get a solid line, but you can also have different kind of styles here. And the way you specify those is, now without any argument, you can just pass a string here that somehow represents a format of your line. So, and again, we see, okay, just passing a single dash represents a straight line, then two dashes represents a dashed line, and dash and dot represents dashes and dots. So this one alternating, and if you have a colon, you have like smaller dots only. So as I told you before, so many arguments in the Matplotlib world have short names. So for example, here we make a bar plot, and then we use the line style argument, the edge color argument, and the line width argument, and those are all abbreviated by just two-letter codes. However, you can also refer to them by using their full names, and I often, yeah, sometimes I tend to forget which are those codes, so I often also use those, and it's also a lot more readable, but just has the exact same result. And now finally, you can also combine the specification of your plotting by combining everything in a so-called format string. So you can, if you call plot, you can just pass a single string here, and then you can say, okay, I want to have this color, then this line style, and then this marker, for example, or this color, this marker, and then this line style in this direction. So if you really want to quickly make or specify different kinds of plot, you can also use those. And so, for example, this means K represents black, and then we have dots, and then we have a dashed, like a solid line. And here we have blue things, and then we have bigger markers, and then we have a dashed line between, and so on and so on. So you can arbitrarily combine them if you like to. So let's try this out in the next exercise, which would be that you should make a plot that has a dotted red line with large yellow diamond markers and a green edge. So this is probably not going to look pretty, but good practice. So you can use the data here as x and y values, and then let's try this out for 4 minutes. So you can also play with different markers if you like to. Okay, so the solution for this would look like this. So very concisely, you could specify that you want to have a red color, then a dotted line, and then diamonds as markers. And then you could say that you want to have the marker face color be yellow and then the marker edge color be green. So and this would then look like this. So these are like a lot of different arguments that you probably need to find out about, and you can customize the different things here. Okay, so we're going to continue with color maps next Thursday, but before that, just two more things. So first thing is that let's see here, that the homework is already up if you want to start on that. Let's see. So last year, so again, it will be about reproducing some plots that we give you and then making them look like this. And the problem last year was that people on different systems had different graphic configurations or whatever, so the plots always looked a bit different. So we try to avoid this time by using a version of matplotlib that should not have this problem. And for this, you need to run the command conner install connerforge label testing, so a testing version of matplotlib. And this, in theory, should also work on Windows and stuff, but no guarantees are made. And if this does not work out for you, then would be nice if you say something early. So I think you can already, so these are the plots that you have to make. I think you can already start with this. And yeah, just try it out if you already have the time. So, and then as a second announcement, if you want to find a place to practice UNO programming skills, we have some announcement to make. So Julia from the Open Knowledge Lab Osnabrück is here to make some advertisement for the hackathon in Osnabrück, right? Do you want to have the mic or do you?